Prepare STL presents What Matters to Me Most with Dr. LJ Punch, trauma surgeon and founder of the TSTL. Learn more at preparestl.com.
Hi, I'm Dr. LJ Punch. We're at the T, a community of health working to reduce the impact of trauma in the St. Louis region. And this is what matters to me most. I've been thinking a lot about the impact of COVID on who's here right now. But what about those who are yet to be? Our future, the next generation, our babies. Today I'm going to be joined by Dr. Cherese Collins, and we're going to grapple with what it means to make a new human in this second year of COVID. We're going to talk about reproductive health and the ways that our whole beings are expressed when we're trying to get through pregnancy and have a baby. And we're going to talk about how we have both the power and responsibility to make choice to support our own well-being and the ways in which we cannot separate those choices from that next new generation waiting to be born from these bodies. Join me in talking with Dr. Collins.
What matters to me most?
I am privileged to be sitting next to Dr. Cherese Collins right now, a OBGYN and community leader serving people and their bodies and attending to the reproductive health of St. Louis. Somebody got to make sure the mamas and the babies are okay. And I'm so glad Dr. Collins is here today to talk to us about COVID and the way that it's impacting her practice and her patients. Dr. Collins, can you just start? Tell us a little bit about your practice and about what you're doing in St. Louis right now.
I was born and raised here and have been back here for 20 years, I should say. I had a private practice in South County, and now I am an employed physician in South County.
Good to have a good job.
Always.
Good to have a good job.
Especially in a pandemic.
Oh, yes, I hear you. So tell me, take us to the office, take us inside the examination room. What are you seeing with COVID and your patients right now?
Absolutely. The first thing, now that we're at a year in the pandemic, I walk in the room and the first thing I ask them is, how are you doing with COVID? If they just answer, I'm okay, I said, no, how is your mental? We're at a year in a pandemic. How are you coping? And typically that opens the door to many different answers. But I've found at a year that there's just not very many people asking about how COVID is affecting people. And we as women tend to keep our emotions inside and tend to take care of everybody else and leave ourselves last. So we don't do a good enough job at self-care at all. But now with the pandemic, a lot of us have gotten lost completely.
Okay, wait a minute. So you are an OBGYN.
And a therapist.
But I'm loving this because if you're tending to the health of women coming to you for care, I love that you're seeing their needs in all the ways that they represent and all the ways that they show up in your exam room.
Absolutely, Dr. Punch. I tell my patients, unlike most specialties where they're just looking at you, your bladder, your lungs, your heart, OBGYN, because of hormones, I have to look at all of you. Your entire well-being is based upon your hormones. If your hormones are off, every cell in every system in your body is off, including your mental. So I have to ask, because unlike other specialties where they can look at you as systems, I might be doing your pap and your breast exam, but I'm doing a lot more. I got to figure out what's going on, because something that's going on with one of your systems may be affecting the other. So you might see your primary care doctor and walk out with four different medicines for four different things, but you might walk out for me and may have one thing because it's going to hit all of your symptoms that you're
experiencing. It's almost like what you're seeing from a psychological and mental health perspective is like a window.
Absolutely.
Wow.
Absolutely. I get a very deep window into people's lives because I'm dealing with them very intimately. I always say I'm the only doctor you get naked with completely.
So talk about it.
You should get naked with a dermatologist too.
Okay.
For them to inspect everything. But in general, I'm usually the doctor that you get completely naked with, so you're already very intimate with me. And then if you have problems, I have to make you feel comfortable very quickly talking to me about those problems. We have a 15 or 30 minute visit. I want to know everything that's going on with you in those 15, 30 minutes.
So tell me, what are a couple of the things you've heard in those moments about the way COVID is impacting people that maybe is even surprising you?
Absolutely. I think the biggest thing is I have a patient who I knew lived alone. And she has several animals, but I knew she has no human. She lives on a lot of land and she doesn't work. So she was already very isolated, and COVID has made that much worse for her, to the point where she was considering, you know, suicide. So you have to think that this people were already alone, and then it's made them even more lonely. And then the people that are working from home, so they're never around anybody. And then they went out to socialize, and now they can't do that. So that's probably the biggest thing, is the people that are alone anyway, but now are alone and isolated.
Ooh, so you're seeing the isolation, you're seeing it show up in the exam room, and how is it showing up for you?
It's exhausting. I pride myself on caring about all my patients. I tell them we have a relationship. Some of my patients have been my patients for over 20 years. So I've watched them get married, graduate from college, maybe get divorced, have children, parents pass. So I have relationships with them. So then when they come in and they tell me that they're hurting or what they're experiencing with a loved one or whatever, I take them home with me. And it's hard to turn that off.
That weight that we as health professionals have carried during this pandemic has been immense, because it's like we're doing the work and then we have this immense weight of knowing the ways in which trauma in the past and in the present is deeply amplifying all of that weight. How is your healthcare surrounding and environment supporting you so that you avoid that very real burnout that is present amongst healthcare professionals right now?
It's difficult, but suggesting vacations in spite of, even I did a staycation. I looked up and realized I hadn't taken any time off in a year.
Right.
So I took the week between Christmas and New Year's and just stayed at home. I took the week of my husband's 50th birthday and stayed with him. We didn't go anywhere. But it was just to back away and be able to say no for a minute and just sit and take care of yourself and your loved ones. I think that's real important. The other thing that I've been doing is I did a retreat. About 6 months into the pandemic, I did a retreat with some other doctors and nurse practitioners. And it's called Project Unplugged. And it's available to any healthcare worker in St. Louis. And it's a 4-week program. You get together on Saturdays. I used to do it as a weekend retreat away. But now that you can't travel, you get together every Saturday for a month. And you discuss how you're feeling, and you learn breathing and meditation. And how to relax. And I have used that in the office in between patients.
There is so much power in the breath, so much power to release that trauma.
Yes.
And find a way forward in your day.
And you feel that negative energy leaving you is so important. And I don't think that people think about the trauma that they carry with them. I know generational trauma is something that we could probably have a whole conversation on, as people, generations of people go through trauma. That's in your DNA.
So you are shepherding today's babies forward and planting seeds so that future generations maybe feel less of the trauma that this pandemic has brought. But I'm curious, right? How do you see COVID changing the experience of making new humans? How is it burdening pregnant bodies, and how are you advising your patients who are considering having a kid?
Well, it was different in the beginning of the pandemic. In the beginning, I don't think people gave it much thought. It was either, I'm not getting pregnant, I'm gonna wait and see where this goes, or life goes on.
Of all the passion I've heard from people when they wanna know, Doc, what do I do? The people who have asked me questions about pregnancy have been some of the most impassioned things, because suddenly, right, it's not just you. I really want to hear your thoughts about the role of the vaccine in pregnant bodies. And I want to hear what you're hearing from people in their considerations. So maybe in the beginning, people were low-key like, okay, whatever, but it's changing now.
So it's definitely changing. So in the beginning, like I said, they were just, it was a choice and they just moved on. Since the vaccine has become available, it has put a completely different spin on things. Because before it was just, we getting pregnant or we not, and I can do my best to shelter in place, et cetera. But then when you start talking about introducing something to me while I'm pregnant, that has become a completely different consideration. So I have some of my patients that are like, absolutely anything that is going to take, you know, to protect me and my baby, absolutely I'll do. And then I have another portion of women that are just like, I don't want to take a Tylenol. You want me to take this vaccine? So it's, I'm having a problem trying to make everybody understand the science. And I have to explain, because pregnant women are very educated and Google is their favorite friend. And so they will look up everything and they will come in. Did you see on the news this morning that the baby had antibodies? I saw that, sweetie. I saw that. So I got to stay one step ahead of them all the time and be completely up on that.
Okay, let's talk about that for a second. So the study I think you're talking about is the study that showed that babies born to mothers who had COVID were born with antibodies to COVID.
Correct.
But also now, for the first time, it's been shown that people who only got the vaccine and didn't have COVID also had babies who were born with antibodies to COVID.
Correct.
So, you know, what does that tell you in terms of the role the vaccine has in pregnancy?
Well, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to go one step back in front of that. What's amazing is that usually antibodies don't cross the placenta at all. So you can get other vaccines and those antibodies may not be detected. COVID, on the other hand, these antibodies are detected in the fluid and in the baby. The virus is not. So that's amazing in and of itself.
Fascinating.
But yeah, so the antibodies are there, and the fact that now we know that you get them from the vaccine, that's ammunition for me. With
so,
my patient.
Okay, wait. Okay, so what I'm hearing is the antibodies that protect and boost your immune response are normally something that a mama can't pass to a baby.
Correct.
But in this scenario, it is possible, which means if you make the choice for your body to get the vaccine, you're not just protecting yourself, you're protecting your baby.
That's exactly the point.
That's some stuff right there, because suddenly it's not just you.
Correct.
Which is your point.
That is exactly my point. It's not just you.
We'll be right back.
Learn about the pros and the cons of the COVID-19 vaccines. Visit preparestl.com to get the facts. Remember, the choice is yours. Prepare STL, helping St. Louisans of color prepare and prevail.
This is What Matters to Me Most with Dr. LJ Punch, trauma surgeon and founder of the TSTL.
And let's also talk about, though, about the way pregnant bodies are more susceptible to COVID.
Absolutely. So being pregnant makes you, puts you into an immunocompromised state automatically.
Immunocompromised, break that down for me.
So your immune system isn't working optimally. It's not working at 100%. In pregnancy, our immune system actually downregulates. And the reason it has to downregulate is because half the DNA of that baby is not yours. It's foreign.
Okay.
So if you recognize that it's foreign, your body is going to attack it and you are going to abort it. So you have to downregulate your immune system to allow these things to occur.
Wow. You know, what I'm hearing here is a clarity from you about the risks and the benefits of adding this vaccine to your body if you're carrying child. And how can we support people to also weigh their risks and benefits if they're thinking about getting pregnant or if they're pregnant?
I think the first thing is to make sure that they understand the science. I think it, the biggest deal in all of this is that an mRNA vaccine is new. Mm. So they are trying to understand, well, this is new. I don't know what that is. I don't want to put that in me. So then I have to back them up and say, we give you the flu shot. Do you take the flu shot? Absolutely, Dr. Collins. Do you know what is in the flu shot every year? Mm. Do you know what's in the Tdap I give you for your whooping cough? Mm-hmm. Take MMR. Do you know what's in that? So for me, trying to explain to them that, yes, this is getting a lot of attention, but this is science in motion. Mm. We don't have the luxury of looking back and saying, oh, we have all of this evidence. The science is moving with the pandemic. So we learned something and we may learn something new the next week and then something new. And so people are getting frustrated with the inconsistency of the messaging. But it's science in motion. Mm. It's working. We're getting answers and they're working.
So I'm hearing from you the power and the necessity of the science to be agile, to adapt.
Yes.
And that for some of us, that feels like threat.
Yes.
But for many of us, it feels like opportunity.
Absolutely.
But you know, the burden that we carry as a people, not always knowing who to trust.
Yes.
Is really heavy.
Absolutely.
What has you, understanding all that, what has you the most hopeful right now? And also, what are you the most worried about as we move forward?
I'm most hopeful at the speed at which this has changed. Mm. When the pandemic first started, people would ask me, Dr. Collins, when do you think this is going to be over? Mm. And my answer was steadfastly, 18 to 24 months from when we get everybody in masks, because we ain't know nothing about a vaccine. So my answer was 18 to 24 months from when everybody was masked. Well, we can't get everybody masked. So I'm hopeful about the vaccine, because if we can get a combination of masking and a majority of people vaccinated, then we may be able to get back to some semblance of normal. I'm also hopeful because there have been some complications we've noted during pregnancies. We're just at a year. So we just started delivering people that had COVID October. We've started to see that we have had some losses during pregnancy in women who have experienced COVID. We've had low fluid, growth restriction. We're starting to see the complications in the babies of the moms who had it, different stages of their pregnancy. So as I see these things, I'm hopeful that I can get more women vaccinated and we don't have to see more of those things, of the bad outcomes secondary to COVID. Mm.
And what has you worried?
That not enough people are gonna believe and get it. That not enough people of color, Black people, are going to believe and get it. I'm finding in my office that there's confusion and there's fear and they're uncomfortable. And I have a steady stream of Black women who have been seeking me out specifically because I look like them. They trust me and I don't take that lightly. So because of that, I feel extremely dedicated to getting people of color vaccinated and to having them understand that it's science. Yes, we've been experimented on. Yes, there have been some unsavory things in medicine in America in the past, but this isn't that. This is a pandemic that we haven't seen in 100 years, and this is science in motion.
So what I'm hearing from you, though, is really interesting because I hear you talking about masks, and I hear you talking about the vaccine. And it is really interesting, the different paths that we have to protect our bodies from infection and to have our bodies as strong as possible to respond to infection. Talk to me about some of the other things we can advise people to do so that they have the best immune system they can have.
Absolutely, and I don't think that we've been talking about that enough in the media. Regarding COVID, 85% of people that have gotten COVID are obese. So we need to talk about that. We need to talk about the obesity. We need to talk about our diet and nutrition, exercise. I don't think a lot of us think about everything we're putting into our bodies. So I think that's real important to talk about
we talked about meditation and your well-being, self-care. Are you sleeping enough? That affects your immune system. Are you eating correctly? If you're eating a lot of fatty and fried foods, that is not good for you. That causes inflammation, which then can allow you to get sick. So eating, drink, or what you drink, your vices, all of that matters. How much you're sleeping and resting, are you clearing your mind? All of those things matter. And so I talk about those things to my patients. Are you eating an anti-inflammatory diet? You know, we talk about eating berries and lemons and things that are alkaline to help decrease inflammation. Those things matter. So if you're not going to get the vaccine, then I need you doing some supplements. I need you eating correctly. I need you sleeping, exercising, and taking care of yourself so you can provide the best care for your baby.
So nobody gets a pass.
No.
Right, Doc? Nobody.
Not
nobody,
at all.
Okay, you made an informed choice for this or for that. Either way, we have the ability every day to make the choices that support our immune health. Eating.
Yes.
Sleeping,
yes.
Our vitamins, our exercise, our mind health.
Yes.
All of that matters too.
I have a pill supplement box for every day of the week, and I have one prescription pill. It's full of supplements to protect my immune system.
So true. So I think for me, you know, what I hear from you is everyone has power.
Yes.
And knowledge is power.
Absolutely.
And whatever choice you make, you need to take the opportunity to express that power, especially if you're trying to bring a new human onto the planet.
Yes. Mm. And my thing is, you just, if you're unsure, then let's talk about it. Let's talk about the information. Don't make an uneducated decision. Get the information. If you want me to give it to you, if you don't want to find it on the media because you don't know who's telling you the truth, I'm gonna tell you the truth, because it's your life, it's your body, it's not mine. So it's so important for me to make sure that when you walk out of my office, you're clear.
I have had so many friends who are pregnant or thinking about getting pregnant, desperate for that level of conversation. They need to know, and they want to know everything. And I think your commitment as a medical professional and as an OBGYN physician to make sure your patients have what they need so they can make an informed choice is exactly the kind of medicine we all need to be practicing right now.
I agree. When patients say to me, I wish all my doctors were like you, my answer to them is, I do too.
Mm.
I do too. We should all be this way. That's why I went into medicine.
Mm.
You go in because you want to help people and you want to make a difference. And I think I'm doing that. I'm doing that with every woman that sits in front of me.
From the mental
all the way.
The physical.
Emotional.
To the emotional.
It all matters to me because it's all part of you.
I love that. It all matters to me because it's all part of you.
That's right.
Beautiful. Thank you, Dr. Collins.
Thank you, Dr. Punch.
Really appreciate your time.
I appreciate you.
What matters to me most?
It all matters to me because it's all a part of you. That, can we just receive that gift for a moment? Can we just sit in that love and that radical acceptance that wherever you are, I see it. Wherever you are, it is precious. Wherever you are, it matters. And I am dedicated to you living the best you that you can possibly be, not just for you, but maybe for the unborn child you carry. My goodness, can we all just receive that blessing? I can't call it anything else but that. In what matters to me most, we've been grappling with helping people center their decisions on their own personal value. But what I heard is the extension, the offering to be seen in that value. Family, that is the kind of love that is going to get us through this pandemic. That is the kind of love that's going to take us into 2022, dry our tears, and unite us in a way that we have never seen before. I am excited, and I am centered. It all matters to me because it's all a part of you. I just got to say amen. I just got to say amen. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Collins, for blessing us and blessing me.
What Matters to Me Most is a presentation of Prepare STL. Prepare STL is a collaboration powered by the Missouri Foundation for Health in partnership with the Regional Health Commission, the City of St. Louis, St. Louis County, and other community health organizations to help prepare all St. Louisans for the effects of the COVID-19 response, how to stop its spread, and how to survive the pandemic physically, emotionally, and economically. Don't miss an episode of the What Matters to Me Most podcast with Dr. LJ Punch, trauma surgeon and founder of the TSTL, for the latest conversations on COVID-19 and STL, vaccines, racial health disparities, physical and emotional well-being, and more. Download the podcast at preparestl.com or wherever you get your podcasts. Executive producer, Vector Communications. What Matters to Me Most is another positive production of Rare Gem Productions.